الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الدين عند الله الإسلام Indeed, the religion, the deen in the sight of Allah is Islam and Islam means submission. That is submission before our Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we'll discuss Islam and secularism. The significance of this subject is that we find a lot of controversy on this subject within the Muslims. Some of us strongly believe that, especially people living in India or in the areas of non-Muslim majority, they honestly believe that their refuge, their protection is in secularism. And they say that there is no harm in being secular individually as well as collectively. On the other hand, some of us have a very strong opinion that there's no room for secularism in Islam and there's no room for Islam in secularism too. They even believe that the real war of Islam is against secularism. Let's analyze and try to understand what is the reality. First of all, we'll take Islam. As I said, it's the submission to will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Islam has introduced itself as deen. Deen literally means return, reward. In Arabic, you will say kama tudinu tudan as an idiom parallel to tit for tat. In Surah Al-Fatiha, we use the word deen in its basic meaning, Maliki Yawmiddin or Maliki Yawmiddin, ruler of the day of reward. What we have done here, you'll be paid back on the day of judgment. So that is the day of reward, the Yawmuddin. Then this word has been used in the Quran in Surah Al-Kafirun as path, as way. Lakum dinukum wali yadin. You go your way and let me go mine. Then in Surah Yusuf alayhi salam, Allah Almighty has described that Zalika kitna li Yusuf. So did we prescribe for Yusuf. Ma kana li ya'khudha akhahu fi dinil malik. As in that law of king, he was not able to detain his brother. You remember the story that Yusuf alayhi salam wanted to detain his brother Binyamin with him. But there was no provision in the law, keeping in mind that Yusuf alayhi salam was a very powerful minister of the king, but he was not the king. And in the king's law, there was only one provision that if someone steals, yes, you can detain him as a punishment. So it was described with the word deen, that in the law of king, in the deen of king, there was no provision to detain his brother. When the word deen is used in the Quran for Islam, it means the whole way of life. Inna deena indallahi al-Islam. The living style, the way of living in the sight of Allah is only Islam. That is, you live according to Allah's will as Allah's slaves. Then we come to the other word, that is secularism. Secularism is the combination of two words. One is ism. Ism means the way of life, the ideology, communism, socialism, and monism, Wahdatul Wujud, is translated in English. Now, this is the combination of two words, secular and ism. Secular means worldly. There were two editions of Oxford Dictionary before me. One was 1960 edition, the other was 1995 edition. So, in 1960 edition, secular was defined as worldly, not religious or spiritual. If the word secular is used as a verb, that is to secularize. In 1995 edition, it was defined as to remove something from control of church. And in 1960 edition, it was to reduce the role of religion in morality and education. Then secularism. Secularism in 1960 edition was defined as the view that influence of the religious organizations should be reduced as much as possible and the morality and education should be separated from religion. And this definition was refined in 1995 edition as laws and education, etc., should be based on facts and science, etc., rather than religion. Now, we come to our subject, that is, what in fact secularism is. Secularism basically has two faces. One is brighter face from their point of view, and I would call it a window dressing of secularism. That is very commonly known to most of us. that secularism means separation of church and state. That the religion and religious affairs and religious obligations and religious sentiments should be separated from the worldly matters, worldly affairs and worldly laws. It can also be defined as an individual is allowed to have any religion. He is allowed to believe in any ideology. But as well as the collective life is concerned, it is not the religion which will rule. It is the opinion of the people that will rule. At this level, secularism allows anyone to have any religion or faith or belief. So it is said that we don't mind whether someone believes in God or he doesn't. So do we don't mind whether he believes in one God, 10 gods, 1000 gods or million gods or even more? Apparently it looks yes, there is a freedom. But when we come to the other side of this definition of secularism or to secularize, that is its role in education, then it really becomes very, very dangerous and detrimental for religion. Although at the levels of law and morality, it is said that they should be based on facts and science, etc. But practically, as I come to that later on, it does have its intervention into the laws also, that in certain laws, if the science and the scientific knowledge doesn't suit secularism, they will go the other way around and they will deny the concrete scientific facts and realities. Although at this level, it's being said that we don't mind if someone believes in God or he doesn't. But it's important to understand, secularism allows you to believe in God just as one worthy of worship or a creator. But if you stress that no, he is my Lord and I would listen to him and I'll follow his direction, secularism will call you an extremist. You are going to the extreme. You are fundamentalist. You are fanatic. That means to say they are allowing human beings to go after their own religion, but in fact they don't allow them. In fact, secular world does not allow human beings to go after their own religion. Similarly, another important aspect of Islam, the religion of Islam, the deen of Islam, is belief in the hereafter. Then belief in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In this connection also, apparently, secularism allows Muslim to believe in Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if we go deep, how much they allow you to believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What our religion demands us to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, secular world allows us to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a great man whom you call a prophet, a man with all the best secular qualities whom you call as your messenger. But secular world doesn't allow us to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in express words that he was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if we really believe this, then we'll follow him, we'll stand by him, we won't listen even a single word against him, we won't allow anyone to insult him. So as far as the belief is concerned, if we go after the belief, all these qualities we must have. So secular world allows us to believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but doesn't allow us to believe in him that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Allah's prophet or Allah's messenger. The role of facts and science in the laws, that you must also understand. With one example, I think you would easily understand what does it mean. First, I quote you the wording, belief that laws and education should be based on facts and science. I leave the education aside. Belief that laws should be based on facts and science, etc. What that does mean? In the last century, there was an act known as Prohibition Act passed in the American Parliament. And according to this law, according to this act, drinking wine, liquor was prohibited completely. And the legislature process of the democratic countries, the procedure is that mostly the government brings a bill or a resolution based on certain reference before the parliament, or some individual privately floats the bill or a resolution in the parliament. Parliament makes a discussion on it. If an issue is serious and deep, a committee is formed. They go into the detail and then finally make recommendation. And again, is presented to the parliament, and then the parliament decides whether to accept or reject that resolution. Vast majority of American people are Christians, and when this bill was passed, were Christians. But the reference for this act was not Bible, which doesn't allow the believers to drink wine. The reference was facts and figures. That's every year this number of people die because of drinking. Every year this number of people, they have cancer because of drinking. This number of people face serious accidents because of drinking. This much burden is on the hospital because of drinking. This much extra burden on police is because of drinking. And every year top secrets are leaked because of drinking. So it's very harmful. So the resolution was brought that it should be banned, and parliament banned drinking. So despite the majority of Americans were Christians, but the reference of this act or this resolution was not Bible, it was facts and figures. Now we come to education. As I said, it's even more detrimental for religion. That is, to control the education system. Secular world allows all the religions to teach their children in the segregated education in their own religious centers. Muslims are allowed to teach their children in the mosque whatever they like, and so the Hindus are allowed to teach their children in mandir, and Sikhs in their gurdwara, Jews in their synagogue, and Christians in their church. But none of them is allowed to bring the religion in school system. That is, every child of the state has to go through a school system, an education system, in which there can be no reference of religion. Nothing that can be taught in school system which is not scientifically proved. Then again, there are three words used: facts and science, etc. What does it mean? What is scientific reality? It's a term, scientific reality. What is scientifically real? Number one, it should be felt through the five senses. Any one of them or all of them, you should be able to touch it. You should be able to see it with your own eyes. You should hear it through your ears. You should taste it through your tongue and smell it through your nose. Anything which cannot be touched, heard, seen, smelt or tasted has got no existence. Number two, yes, if it cannot be felt through five senses, at least it should be verified through these senses. Even then it's a reality. For example, electromagnetic waves. Science claims that they're all around electromagnetic waves, but we can't see them, we can't touch them, we can't hear them, we can't taste them, we can't smell them. But I'll turn my mobile phone on and mobile data, and I see the signals of Wi-Fi. I just enter the password and I get connected to the whole world through an unseen system, an unseen medium. So it's proved that yes, there are waves which I cannot see, touch, hear, smell, or taste. Then furthermore, etc. This means one example. There can be many which are proved by science. I give you one example. Then that is mathematical calculation. Mathematics is an approved method, scientific method, that anything which is proved by calculation, that is also real. Although it cannot be seen, it can't be touched, it can't be heard, etc., etc. But if it's proved through the mathematical calculation, that is also real. So I give you the example for that also. Anyone who has studied physics and he has studied the mathematical equation of Einstein, as he was a mathematician, E is equal to mc square. According to this equation, Einstein mathematically proved, not physically, mathematically proved, that whenever an object moves with the velocity of light, it turns to energy. And for this, time becomes infinite and distance becomes zero. I believe none of us has practically experienced this, but every student of physics believes in it. Yes, if an object moves with the velocity of light, it will turn to energy. So this is our belief in science and scientific methods. And how we are able to believe in this? Because we are secularized. What actually the secular way of thinking is? Now we come to Islam. That what effect this scientific way of thinking, this mindset affects Islam? Now, first of all, we come to the basic beliefs. The basic belief of a Muslim is in Allah. That we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists. He is the creator. He is the ruler of this universe, and He is dependent on none, independent, ghani, and everything else is dependent on him. When we go through secular education, and the real education is that you understand what you are reading, you understand what your teacher is teaching, the real student does it. Of course, there is a good number of students who just study to get through, to get a degree. And when they get a degree, they throw away the books and scratch from their minds what they studied totally, and they come to the practical life. But the real students are those who understand what they are studying and what they are being taught by their teacher. And if yes, if a Muslim young man through his education starts really feeling that anything which is not felt by the five senses or is not verified by the five senses or cannot be proved by the scientific methods has got no reality, he cannot believe in God. What to talk of anything else? So the basic belief of Islam, of the Muslims, is belief in Allah. If he doesn't believe in the existence of God Almighty, then how can he be Muslim anymore? Now, let's trace the word religion to, what does it mean? In the Oxford Dictionary, I traced the word religion to, interestingly, in the 1960 edition of Oxford, the definition of religion was belief in the existence of a supernatural ruling power, the creator and controller of the universe, who has given man a spiritual nature which continues to exist after death of the body. And then, after semicolon, a course of action or a practice regarded as a ruling passion of one's life. You know, the first definition of religion, if you just read, you will feel that, oh, it's the definition of Islam. But if you read it carefully, you'll say, no, it's not the definition of Islam. Belief in the existence of a supernatural ruling power. The question is, if Allah Ta'ala, God Almighty, a power? No, He's not a power. He is a powerful being. There's a hell of difference between the two. No? Power, just like a machine, just like a computer, He has no choice, no will of its own. Whereas, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is a personified being who has all the power, who has all the knowledge, who has all the capabilities. He is omnipotent, omni-hearing, omni-watching, merciful, kind, and very stern to retribute. All these are His qualities. Whenever there is a personified being, there will be liking and dislike, appreciation and depreciation. So all these things have to continue. If you believe in this definition, that belief in the existence of a supernatural ruling power, you will not be believing in Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Because He is a powerful being, not a power. Yes, the second part of the definition is close to Islam, that Allah Almighty has given man a spiritual nature. Not exactly, but it's close to what Islam is, which continues to exist after death of the body. Though I will say that that is not a nature. That is actually another personified being, a soft personified being, which Allah Almighty has blessed man with. And that doesn't die with his body. When a man dies, yes, his body dies, but his soul is taken away to another world. This is what we believe. The second part of the definition was a course of action or a practice regarded as the ruling passion of one's life. But this definition was certainly the definition of Islam, that religion is a ruling passion of one's life. This lies inside man and it rules the whole thinking process and the practice of that individual. But in 1995 edition, it appears that Freud's view has dominated and the definition has been amended. Freud is one of those people who have a remarkable influence in the history of mankind, other than the messengers, I believe. Newton is one of them, Darwin is another, and so is Freud. He claimed that religion has no influence in human nature. Man is just an animal, but certain religious influential people have tried to influence and control mankind through religions which have no origin of their own. So, the definition, the course of action or a practice regarded as the ruling passion of one's life was amended to a particular system of faith and worship. No, wording has been changed. The other was the course of action or a practice. The change is a particular system of faith
and worship.
No, the practice has been taken away. Action has been taken away. A particular system of faith and worship based on religious belief. And after semicolon, controlling influence of one's life. Passion always arises from inside. And influence always comes from outside. So, in the 1960 edition, religion was a passion. But in 1995 edition, it turned to a controlling influence, which controls man from outside, but it has got no origin within. When you go through the secular education and you are really intelligent and you understand what you read, what you study, then your mindset changes. And that is why a good number of Muslim young men, after going through this secular education, turn to be the non-believers. They said, there's no God, there's no religion, I have got no religion, I was born with no religion. Oh yes, my father was a Muslim, my mother was a Christian, but I have no religion. That is the influence of a secular education. It apparently, at the state level or the political level, secularism allowed anyone to believe in whatever he wants to believe. Whether he wants to believe in God or he doesn't, he believes in one God, 10 gods or million gods. But through the education system, it changed the mindset of the younger generation and they turned non-religious inadvertently without coming to know that they are being transformed through that education system. Some of them said, oh, religion is the opium of the masses. Masses are controlled through religion, but the intelligent people, those who have understanding, they are not supposed to follow the religion. They should do whatever they want to do. That is permissivism. Everything is allowed. Permissive. Then there are changes in the mindset of the Muslims through the secular education, which we must understand. You know, this is a requirement of the secular world also, that our workers should be honest to us. They shouldn't lie to us. Now the question is, how you can make them not to lie and not to cheat? So they will promote it as moral values. Now, the Muslims also will promote these values. Of course, these are Islamic values. But a Muslim's belief in moral values is different and its promotion is different. Why shouldn't I cheat you? I am a professional man and you come to me for consultation and I don't believe in the hereafter. I don't believe in Allah. Why should I be honest to you? Because if as a professional I give you honest advice, and I tell you that you don't need any filling in your teeth, then who will suffer? I'll suffer. You will gain. Similarly, you go to a lawyer and consult, and he tells you that your case is very weak. Ultimately, you will not hire him to fight for you in the court. Who will suffer? The lawyer will suffer. You will gain. This is what you find, that in the secular world, their honesty is limited to a certain level only. That is, they have to promote patriotism, which again is an ideology. To be patriotic is not to be 100% secular. Because why you draw a line? So the secular world is patriotic and they will not cheat their own people. They will not lie to their own people. But outside their own country and for people other than their own nationals, they will lie, they will cheat. They will be kind even to the pets of their country. But outside the country, they will kill humanity as if they are cutting vegetables. This is the influence. But yes, if you feel that yes, honesty is the part of my nature, so I have to be honest anyway. I have to be truthful. It is the demand of my nature. And to prove that I have true nature, I have not to lie to anyone. This is the base in Islam. But remember, in Islam, belief in Allah and belief in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is above that. From the deeper Islamic value, we are Allah's slaves. Allah Ta'ala is our master. He is our Lord. And we are Allah's slave. Now, how these things are influenced by secularism? The oldest English translation, oldest I mean the verified and certified English translation of the Quran, was by Mr. Marmaduke Pickthall, Muhammad Marmaduke Pickthall. He very frankly translates word ab as slave. But as the secular influences advanced and Europe was replaced by America in ruling the world, So values changed. The next English translation, which was famous like that of Pickthall, was English translation with tafsir of Professor Abdullah Yusuf Ali. He is reluctant to use the word slave. He uses the word bondsman. And then in the end of last century, Dr. Mohsin Khan translated the Quran and used the word humble servant for abd. The question is slave and servant equal? No matter a servant, how humble is he? He is a servant. He is a free man, not a slave. The question is, Allah Almighty created us, not with our will, with His own choice. The way He wanted. Wherever He wanted, He brought us to birth. So we are Allah's slave. I am Allah's slave. So was my father, my grandfather, and so was my four grandfather, Adam alayhi salam. I was born as a slave. I am now a slave. I will die as a slave. And I will get up on the day of judgment as a slave. This is the real ideology of Islam. But when we become secular, we gradually try to come out of Allah's slavery. So this is the influence of secular education. Allah Almighty has asked us to speak the truth and act honestly. If, for example, our Lord Himself, who has asked us to tell the truth and act honestly today, if tomorrow same Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asks me to lie or asks me to cheat, it will be my duty that I must lie and I must cheat. As in the secular world, in the patriotic domains, you have to be honest here and dishonest there. You have to speak the truth here and you have to lie there. A Muslim's approach would be that I speak the truth because my Lord doesn't allow me to tell a lie. I act honestly because my Lord Almighty doesn't allow me to cheat. So this is the Islamic values, Islamic perspective. Now, secularism, the secular education I'm talking about, it has influenced us that way. And again, in the political arena, secularism doesn't allow Muslims to believe in Allah as their Lord. Whereas from the Holy Quran, we find that the mushriks of Makkah believed in Allah as creator with Tawheed. لَإِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Many times in the Quran it has been announced, O Messenger, if indeed you ask them who created heavens and the earth, فَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهِ, they would certainly say Allah. And not only that, in Surah Yunus ayat number 30 and 31, قُلْ مَنْ يَرْزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Ask them, who provides you from heaven and earth? أَمَّنْ يَمْلِكُ السَّمَاءَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ. Or who controls their ears and eyes? وَمَنْ يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ يُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ. And who extracts living from the dead and dead from the living? وَمَنْ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرَ. And who plans affairs? سَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهُ, they would certainly say Allah. فَقُلْ أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. Then ask them, why don't you fear Him? فَذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمُ الْحَقُّ. Then tell them, this very Allah, whom you believe as provider, as one who brings to life and puts to death, and one who has a control on your ears and eyes, and who plans all the things, is your real Lord. So Allah Almighty has introduced Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Lord. But due to the secular influence, not only this, that we are not allowed to believe in Him as Lord. Rather, if a Muslim believes in Allah as his Lord, he is labeled as extremist in the secular terms. Why? They should be honest. Secular world should be honest. That if he says that we don't poke our leg into the religion, we give freedom of religion, why don't the secular world give freedom to Muslims to believe in Allah Almighty as their Lord? Because the demand of our religion is to believe in Allah as our Lord. So is the case of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Secular world allows us to believe that he was a very, very honest and truthful person, very kind to everybody, and he was high class statesman, a very sensible man, very good father, very good husband, this. But secular world doesn't allow us to believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Allah's messenger, as I have explained earlier. secular word, let me say, is a virus. Secularism is a virus which gets into us without letting us know that we are being attacked by this virus. And we are sick of this disease without coming to know that we have been attacked by this disease. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He makes us all understand what Islam is, what does it demand, and how secularism takes our religion, Islam, away from us. آخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
هي الحلقات تحفظني بآيات من القرآن، هي الحلقات تملأني بحب المصطفى العدنان، هي الحلقات تحفظني.